Okay, so in this clip, we're going to look at how momentum and Newton's laws are linked together, specifically for this one, the first and second law. Now, Newton's first law basically states that an object will keep doing whatever it's doing unless it's acted on by an external force, that being a resultant force. So in usual scenarios, every object's acted on by forces all the time, but those forces might be imbalanced, making the resultant force zero, so therefore keeping the motion constant. So by Newton's first law, if there's no resultant force, then that means there's no acceleration, so an object stays at constant velocity. And if it's at constant velocity, that means momentum's not changing, so momentum can also be considered to be constant when we've got zero resultant force. However, if we look at Newton's second law, that states that if there is a resultant force, there will be an acceleration, and that acceleration will be proportional to the force. And we know that well because that is given by force is mass times acceleration. Okay, so if we think about that now, we've also met Seebeck equations where we've looked at acceleration being given by V minus U over T. So force is now equal to that. If we multiply that equation through by the M, we're given force is MV minus MU all divided by T. And what we've got here is an expression where MV is the final momentum and MU is the initial momentum. So effectively, we've got a factor in here that is change in momentum. So force is delta MV over T, which would be delta P for momentum divided by T. We've actually got ourselves a brand new definition for force here, where force is the rate of change of momentum. And that's actually probably a more useful definition of force than anything we've met before. Force is the rate of change of momentum. We can also have a little bit of a play around with this equation, rearrange it. So if we've got FT equals delta P, then the quantity here, FT, is also known as the impulse, where the impulse is what's required to change the momentum. So impulse and change momentum being sort of the same thing here. So this is known as an impulse. And if we look at the units for that, force measured in newtons, time measured in seconds, we actually have a new unit for momentum here, Newton seconds. So kilogram meters per seconds and Newton seconds dimensionally are the same thing. So momentum can be measured in either of those units as we work through, and that's worth remembering. Now what we're going to do is look at some of the practical implications of this as an equation and think about how that's useful when we come to things like vehicle design. And to do that, we'll have a look back at the incident that happened at the start of the video, which is taken from one of my favourite ever episodes, Thomas the Tank Engine, called The Flying Kipper. Go back to thinking about Henry's crash then and what happened in those snowy and icy conditions, and think about how much worse it could have been if Henry had hit something like a solid object, like a wall. Now, Henry's a fast moving and very large train, so it's going to have a very high momentum, which means it's going to need a very big impulse to bring that momentum down to zero and stop him. So as Henry comes in, hits the wall, there's not much absorption of energy going on here. It's going to bring him to rest very suddenly. Very suddenly means a very small time. So for that large change in momentum, the large impulse we need, if we've got a very small time, we're going to need an extraordinarily large force. That's going to mean a huge impact, lots of damage, and probably a lot of crying young children when they realise what's happened to Henry. However, fortunately, he crashed into an object a little bit more like this. Okay, so the stationary wagons that he crashes into, as he comes in, they collapse and they change shape and they move. And what that means is the impact happens over a longer period of time, brings him to rest more slowly. So if the time is longer, as the impact is absorbed by everything over here, that means the force actually transferred to Henry can be much smaller for the same change in momentum. And actually, that is probably what saves Henry. It means he can just be rebuilt at Crewe and given a new shape later on in the series. So crucially, we've got
a situation where if we can increase the time of a collision, we can reduce the force in that collision for the same change in momentum.
If we think of some real world situations where this happens, the most common ones to think about are in cars. So a car with a driver in it. And if we look at the acceleration period of that, quite often what will happen is as the car accelerates, friction between the driver and the car on the car seat will mean that force is transferred to the driver and the driver accelerates as well. Obviously, if you go try and accelerate very quickly, you'll feel that experience of being thrown back into your seat. What's really happening there is that the chair itself isn't providing enough friction. So the seat kind of slips from under you and it's the back of the seat catching you up and applying a force to accelerate you that is really what you're experiencing. Although it feels like you've been thrown back in your seat, what's really happening is the seat is rushing forward to meet you. If we think about a braking situation, similar things happen. If you brake slowly, there's enough friction between the driver and the seat to bring the driver to rest as well. However, if you brake very suddenly, the force required, so small time, the force required to drop to stop the driver will be much quicker, and perhaps the friction in the seat won't be enough to provide that. So the driver therefore carries on and is thrown forward. And that's the sort of thing that happens in an accident. Okay, now the next thing that will happen to the driver there is they will hit the steering wheel or the windscreen, okay, which will bring them to stop in a very short amount of time, big force, a lot of damage will be done. So what in safety considerations we need to do is find a way to increase the time that the driver stops for to reduce the force. And there's three main things in a car that will do that. The obvious one for the driver that we can start with is a seatbelt. So a seatbelt, what it does is it doesn't lock immediately on impact, because that would again be a very short amount of time and would actually do a lot of damage to the driver. What it does is it gives a little bit first. That means that it will increase the time the driver slows down for, reduce the force on the driver, and massively therefore reduce any injuries that take place. The next thing, airbag. Same concept, instead of hitting your head straight on the steering wheel, a hard object, short time, large force, the airbag will bring the head to rest over a much larger period of time, absorbs the impact, and reduces the force on the driver. Final one is something that will apply to the whole car and was applicable to Henry's accident earlier, is a crumple zone. The brake van from earlier acted as a crumple zone. It buckled, which meant that the crash lasted for longer. And in the front of a car, same thing will apply. There'll be a crumple zone, which means the car will collapse, absorb the energy of the impact over a longer period of time. And if the time is longer, then the force is smaller and the driver will remain more safe.